Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back. I hope you've enjoyed your lunch today. I used to be a teacher in a school. And the one class that you never wanted to be asked to teach was the one after lunch. Because it's warm outside. Many of you are up very early this morning. You've had a big lunch. You've had some coffee. Now it's time to sleep.
So
I'm going to set you responsible for the person next to you. So if the person next to you falls asleep, it's your fault. I will hold you accountable for the person next to you. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Do we have a deal?
Yeah.
Well, God bless you. I'm looking at God's special forces. Because of what God said to me. And I discovered over the last number of years. That when God speaks to me. That it's usually not just for me. And so I offer this to you. Today and tomorrow, as a possibility of what God is saying. The Bereans were more noble than the Thessalonians because they examined the Word of God to see if what Paul said was true. And so the wonderful thing about the witness of the Holy Spirit is that there is an amen inside of us when we hear something when it's God. Now, of course, there's the opposite when we don't feel that. So, if you don't feel that today and tomorrow, just keep quiet. And when you get home to your wife or your husband, complain then. At the end of the day, we are brothers and sisters here seeking the mind of God, asking the Holy Spirit what He wants to speak to us. So God brought me through a journey last year of emptiness. But I discovered that God is always attracted to emptiness. If we're full, we don't need Him. But when we're empty, it attracts God to come and fill us once again. And so when this lady shared with me in Texas, on that passage from 1 Kings chapter 13. And then I was awoken by God in the middle of the night, where God said to me, there will be specific things you will have to do. And it has changed the way I'm trying to do things. So I'm trying to be more concentrated on what God wants. Last year I traveled intensely. And so far this year I am very busy. But I'm trying to ensure that the places I go are the places God wants me to go. We can achieve far more by being specific in what God wants us to do. So in your church as a pastor, you might have a few young boys in your church. who God has put his hand on and wants you to invest more into them than into anybody else. Or there may be an area your church needs to outreach in. That's the wonderful thing about the Holy Spirit. As he takes the things of God and makes them real to us. So that we can be like an arrow that hits the bullseye. Rather than shooting randomly at all times. If we could do that, then maybe our ministry would land more on good soil. So that we'd see the 30-fold and the 60-fold and the 100-fold. Before we broke for lunch, I was looking at Philip.
Philip?
Yeah.
Yes.
An amazing character. And I did ask you the question that cannot be answered. Why did God choose Philip? Why did he not use one of the apostles? And as I said to you and want to emphasize, this is not a negative view towards the apostles. The apostles had no knowledge of this. This was God choosing his man to do a specific thing with a specific target at a specific time. And as we go through the rest of today and tomorrow, I will be re-emphasizing that. So what I'm expecting God to do with you is that he will open up your mind and open up your ministry so that your generalizations will become more specific. And that you will start to hear specific words from God for people, for nations, and for situations. So God can do that. And it's amazing as I read that story in 1 Kings that the word of God was for the altar, not for Jeroboam. Because had it been for Jeroboam, it would have failed. But God put something into order. And 300 years later, it actually was fulfilled. When God chose Philip, I've written some things down in your notes. He led this man to Jesus, and the man went away rejoicing. And it's a wonderful gift from God to be able to see somebody rejoicing and to not have to get the glory for it. To be able to walk away and it's enough that Jesus was glorified. And all of us as ministers deal with that. Pastors do. Because you work in a church place, and there will always be people in your church who think you are wonderful. Pastors, you will have ladies in your church, and they think the sun shines on you.
Pastors,
we have a wonderful principle to give honor where honor is due. And it's good to give honor where honor is due. Of course. But we have to be very careful that we don't believe our own publicity. So when somebody says how wonderful you are, If they say that to you continually, you will start to believe how wonderful you are. Pastor, you're wonderful.
Pastor,
you're wonderful. Yes.
Look,
I am wonderful. Amen, sister. Glory to God. And that's okay to a degree. But we need to point to Jesus. So with this group of people, special agents, I believe it takes a special grace and a special gift to be able to walk away without somebody knowing that I was the one who led him to Jesus. Please, somebody, remember me. I need to be remembered. Isn't it interesting when we see on buildings, you know, erected to the glory of God in memory of so and so?
ንጻላይ ለምሳሌ መሰረት ድንጋይ ላይ ለእግዚአብሔር ክብር ከሌለ ለማስተዋወስ ተብሎ ይጻፋል.
But Jesus didn't say to do any of that in memory of him.
ኢየሱስ ግን ይሄንን አርጉልኝ አላለ.
The only thing he chose to remember him was bread and wine.
እሱን አስተዋወሱኝ ያለው በህብስቱና በወይኑ ብቻ.
When you walk into a building, we don't remember Jesus.
And this all I said to Jesus and Nassau.
We might think how beautiful the building is.
It's all wonderful and natural.
But when we take bread and wine,
can have us to
communion.
Wainun. የጌታን እራት ስንወስድ
celebrate his broken body.
የተቆረሰውን ስጋ
ስንወስድ
በዚያ አስቡኛል.
Important for us to learn that.
So Philip,
even if it wasn't his choice,
ምርጫው እንኳን ባይሆን
God took him away.
Not ozorra daragaw gziare
to a place called Azotus.
Odeni afsefra.
And he started to preach there.
Zaino masbak
jema. Just continue doing what he was already doing.
Katno bagaregilotun nabar.
Qatil. And God blessed him.
Gziare barak.
And we see later on in the scripture how God blessed him.
Kwala bekedisat mezaf indet indetabarakna.
When Paul came back from one of his missionary journeys.
Paulos kandu teliko kebuzo simmelles.
It was Philip's house he went to.
But Philip was better than Arafo.
When Agabus, one of the most famous prophets of that day, when he prophesied and took off Paul's belt, was at Philip's house.
But Philip was better than Arafo.
So Philip had this ability to point people to Jesus.
Philip was ሰዎችን ወደ ኢየሱስ የመጠቆም ችሎታ ነበር.
But then God sent people his way to his house.
እግዚአብሔር ደግሞ ሰዎችን ወደሱ ወደ ቤቱ መላክ ጀመረ.
So he hosted prophets.
ነቢያትን በቤቱ ያሳድራል.
He hosted missionary teams.
መልእክተኞችን በቤቱ ያስተናግዳል.
A movement of the Spirit was made through his place.
Yeah, በሱ ቤት የመንፈስ ቅዱስ እንቅስቃሴ ይኖራል.
But he worked in the background.
ግን ከኋላ ነው የሚሰራው.
And normal rules did not apply for him.
እና መደበኛው ደንብ ለሱ ጋር አይሰራም.
What an amazing special agent he was.
ምን አይነት ልዩ ኃይል አባል ነበር ይሄ ሰው.
And that's what God wants for you.
እግዚአብሔር ለእናንተም የሚፈልገው ይሄን ነው.
I want to look at another few.
ሌላውን ደግሞ እንመልከት.
And in this session I want to look at one called Ananias. And really, we know next to nothing about this man. These are key passages in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 8, we have the story of Philip. Where God wanted to open up the continent of Africa. And so the key was a man called Philip. In Acts chapter
9,
God wanted to open up Europe
አውሮፓን መክፈት ፈለገ እግዚአብሔር.
And the whole missionary world.
ከዛ የሚሽነሪውን ዓለም መክፈት ፈለገ.
Through the apostle Paul.
ባዋሪው ጳውሎስ በኩል.
But the key that he used was a man called Ananias. In Acts chapter 10, God wanted to open up the Gentile world. So he used a very unusual person. The key for me was a man called Cornelius, who did not even know God or Jesus at that time. So I suggested to you earlier on, the same as a lady said to me in Texas, you're dealing with the keys, but perhaps you are the key. And so as you work as a special agent for God, yes, you're carrying the information. You're carrying the message. You're perhaps carrying the theology, the teaching. But you're not carrying keys any longer. You are the key. And in the situations God thrusts you into, you are the key. When my brother was in the special air service, I never knew what he got up to, but I know that they were used for special operations. Top secret operations that no one should ever find out about. Only between him and the commanders and his team of four that he worked with. But they would be trained for a special operation. Maybe it's a hostage situation. And the premises they had to go in would be built in their grounds. And they would practice, they would be shown everything and shown the layout of the building. And they would practice until they knew that, then they would do the operation. But no one would ever know. They never were allowed to talk about what they did. Because they were working, sure, for the government, for the queen at that time. Or for us, please pray for my boy. My boy Isaac is in the army. And he had to swear allegiance to the queen. Queen Elizabeth. Before she died. Well, of course, when she died, now Prince Charles is King Charles.
Prince Charles, Nugus Charles Soro.
So now his allegiance is to the king. But he doesn't like the king, so I have to work with him. I said, your responsibility now is to the king. And nobody will need to know. So for Philip, he did not need to advertise what he did. We only know it today because it's recorded in the scripture. Some of you God has used in an incredible way here. And for most of what you have done, no one will ever write it down in the history of Ethiopia. But I can tell you one person has written it down, and that is God. God has written it down. In fact, he wrote it down before you did it. In a book. Not the Lamb's Book of Life. Another book. Where God wrote your days before you were even
born.
And so God wants to lay his hand on you.
So let's examine
as a special agent
who
was tuned in to listening to him. That means time. That means effort. Now, as we become successful in what we do, demands on our time become greater and greater. greater.
ጊዜያችን እየተጣበበ ይመጣል.
I remember one of the years, one of your pastors, I haven't seen him for a few years, who had a church somewhere on the ring road around Addis Ababa.
A young man.
Maybe some of you will remember him, but his church went from a small church to one of the blossoming areas and grew from a small number to 1,000. 900 and something, I think it was. And when you're in a small church, everybody can have your mobile number, you know. I remember saying to him, hey, don't be giving your mobile number to anybody. If you're dealing with 10 people, 20 people in a small church, you can be intimate with them. If you've got 1,000 people, you somehow have to negotiate those people contacting you. And let me tell you, they'll kill you. Church people will kill you. If you allow it to. Because let me tell you this, pastors are nice people. I'm a traveling evangelist. I'm not nice. I don't have to be nice. I can be nasty. Because I'm getting on a plane in 2 days' time. Doesn't matter. You can't be nasty. Because you've got to see the person next week again. And I'm joking with this. Partly. But I know pastors who are up very early in the morning. They never turn their mobile phone off. Because they're more important than God. And if you're more important than God, you need your mobile on. Leave it on during the night. If you leave your mobile phone on during the night, you're an idiot. Just let that sink in for a moment. I'm not functioning as a pastor. Because the devil will arrange for every one of your congregation to ring you. I'm just letting that sink in for a moment. Because one or two of you are giving me dirty looks now. Listen to me. Let me ask you a question. How much time was set aside for God this morning? Last week, how many hours were set aside? Just you and him. No committee. No deacons. No elders. No sermon preparation. Just you and him. I don't want to hear the answer to that because it's none of my business. Because I have to ask that question for me. But let me tell you something. In my traveling ministry, if I stand in the pulpit and have not heard from God and try to tell you something clever, I might get away with it for a week or two. But eventually, the truth will be told. He's heard nothing from God. He's just teaching from experience. And if by gift of speaking gives me the ability to get through, then I'm in trouble. And my people are in trouble. So what I'm saying to you, and this is a serious point. I have to turn aside from people and say to God, you're more important for this next hour. So if you are successful today in your ministry and your deacons or your board or your elders, whoever they are, are making life so busy for you that you don't have time for God. Let me give you a recommendation. Resign.
Resignation.
Because you're wasting your time. Now you didn't expect me to say that. I am overemphasizing to try and put a point across. God spoke to me. I felt God speak to me a few weeks ago. I was listening in a service in America. And the man was speaking from Revelation. Was it the church of Ephesus? Do the things you did at first. And when I was in my 20s and 30s, I used to walk for hours. And I used to hear from God and spend time in His presence. Now I don't have time for walking. So I felt God say to me, stop. Go back to doing what you were doing. So I'm going to do that. But that means I've got to change some things. And say no to something. Because this is so important. My brother, when he heard instructions from the commander, he had to act immediately. And those instructions were the most important thing that he could hear. And so for us, our instructions from the King of Kings are the most important things that we will hear. Now in this Ananias character, he lived in a city called Damascus. Now Damascus is in Syria. And it has been nearly destroyed over this last few years. You'll have followed what's going on in Syria over the last
while.
Damascus is one of the oldest cities in the world. According to Josephus, it was founded by the grandson of Shem.
The same,
Noah, Shem, Ham, Japheth.
Noah, same,
Noah. And the grandson, a guy called Uz.
Uz,
it's mentioned in the time of Abraham.
218
kilometers northeast of Jerusalem. A place with a great smell. It's called the city of Jasmine. I've never been there. I looked up and saw the population is somewhere between 2.5 and 4 million. Though I don't know if that is accurate with what has gone on over the last few years. In 1950, the population was
414,000.
Ancient Damascus only had two streets. One going from east to west, called Straight Street, and one going from north to south. One of the roads is 1.5 kilometers long, the other one 1 kilometer. It was the Romans that built a wall around the edge of the city. We know there was a wall because Paul, remember, was let down in a
basket.
In the time of Paul, there were approximately 50,000 Jews living in Damascus. And you remember the wicked Nero. Nero was the one who put Christians into barrels and covered them with tar and made them light up his garden at night. He was a wicked, wicked man. And he slaughtered 10,000 Jews in Damascus.
Damascus, 10 ሻይሁድን አሳረደው.
So we know about Damascus.
ስለ ደማስቆ እናውቃለን.
If you ask any of your congregation,
የጉባኤ አባላታችሁን ብትጠይቁ,
what do you know about Damascus?
ስለ ደማስቆ ምን ታውቃላችሁ ብትሏቸው,
they will tell you about Paul of Damascus or Saul of Damascus.
ስለ ሳውል ይነግሯቸዋል በደማስቆ ሳውል ይሏቸዋል.
We know the story that he was outside the city.
በከተማይቱ ደጃፍ ላይ.
In fact, we'll read a little bit of it. Acts chapter 9.
የሐዋርያት ሥራ ምዕራፍ 9.
And verse 1 to... Oh, no, no. We'll read verse 1 to 9 to start with.
ሐዋርያት ሥራ 9 ከአንድ እስከ 9 ያነባለው. ሳውል ግን የጌታን ደቀ መዛሙርት ለመግደል አሁንም እየዛተ ወደ ሊቀ ካህኑ ሄደ. የጌታን መንገድ የሚከተሉትን ወንዶችንም ሆኑ ሴቶች በዚያ ካገኘ አስሮ ወደ ኢየሩሳሌም ለመውሰድ እንዲችል ለደማስቆ ለነበሩት ምክራቦች ደብዳቤ እንዲሰጠው ሊቀ ካህናቱን ለመነው. ደማስቆ ለመድረስ ጥቂት ሲቀረው ብርሃን ከሰማይ ድንገት በዙሪያው አንጸባረቀበት. እርሱም በምድር ላይ ወደቀ. በዛ ጊዜም ሳውል ሳውል ለምን ታሳድደኛለህ የሚል ድምፅ ሰማ. ሳውልም ጌታ ሆይ አንተ ማን ነህ አለው. እርሱም እንዲህ አለው, እኔማ አንተ የምታሳድደኝ ኢየሱስ ነኝ. አሁንም ተነስተህ ወደ ከተማይቱ ግባ, ማድረግ የሚገባህ ይነገርሃል. ሳውል ጋር ይጓዙ የነበሩትም ሰዎች ድምፁን እየሰሙ ማንንም ባላዩ ጊዜ አፋቸውን ይዘው ቆሙ. ሳውልም ከወደቀበት ተነስቶ አይኑን ሲገልጥ ምንም ማየት አልቻለም. ስለዚህ ሰዎቹ እጁን ይዘው እየመሩ ወደ ደማስቆ አስገቡት. ሶስት ቀንም ታወረ, እህል ውሃም አልቀመሰም.
This man Saul was a wicked man.
ይህ ሳውል ክፉ ሰው ነው.
And yet he was a man who thought he was doing what God wanted him to do.
ግን እግዚአብሔርን እያገለገለ ነበር የሚመስለው.
And when Stephen, one of the other deacons, was martyred,
Stephanos betesewa gize,
it says that the men who stoned him laid their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul.
Dengai miogulut sewoch lebsachon sebsmu metebekallachew Saul nabare.
So he was a charismatic, intelligent young man.
ስለዚህ በጣም አመሮ የተሳለ ሰውን ማሳመን የሚችል አይነት ሰው ነበር.
With a mission.
ተልኮ ነበር.
To do what he thought God wanted him to do.
እግዚአብሔር አድርግ ያለው መስሎት.
To destroy the way.
በዚህ መንገድ ያሉትን ሰዎች ለማጥፋት.
So he did that in Jerusalem.
በኢየሩሳሌም ይሄን አድርጓል.
And got permission from the leaders in Jerusalem to go to Damascus.
ኢየሩሳሌም መሪዎች ደግሞ ፈቅደውለታል ወደ ደማስቆ.
And to try and destroy this young church in Damascus.
በደማስቆ የምታጎደቁት ቤተክርስቲያን ለማክሰም.
And we've just read the story.
ታሪኩን አረበባና.
On the way this bright light from heaven.
ወደዛ እየሄደ ያለ በጣም ደማቅ ብርሃን ከሰማይ ወረደ.
So dramatic he falls off his horse.
አይመኛ ከመሆኑ የተነሳ ከፈረሱ
ወደቀ. And hears the voice speaking to him.
ድምፅ ሲናገር ሰማ.
And it changes his life forever.
ይወጡ ለዘላለም ተለወጠ.
On two further occasions when he's given his testimony, this is what he talks about.
ሁለት ጊዜ እንደገና ይሄን ምስክርነቱን ሲያነሳው እናያለን.
And also in his testimony he remembers Stephen being martyred.
በመስከረነቱ እስጢፋኖስ እንዴት እንደተገደለ ይናገራል.
But this was a dramatic testimony.
ይሄኛው ግን አስደናቂ ምስክርነት ነበር.
And when we use it actually for people in the church, he's got a Saul of Damascus testimony.
እና ሳይለኛ ምስክርነት ሲኖረው እንደ ደማስቆ አይነት ምስክርነት ነው እንላለን.
Somebody who was a thief or somebody who was a murderer and they came to Christ, but they were like Saul of Damascus.
ይባይ ነበር ነፍሰ ገዳይ ነበር ወደ ጌታ ሲመጣ ይሄማ የደማስቆ ሳውል አይነት ምስክርነት ነው ባለ.
But God has his hand on his life.
እግዚአብሔር ግን እጁን በሳውል ላይ ጭኗል.
And so Jesus reveals himself to him.
ኢየሱስ ራሱን ገለጠለት ለሱ.
Now he believes it's Jesus for sure.
ኢየሱስ እንደሆነ አመነ.
Because he calls himself an apostle.
ራሱን ሐዋርያ ብሎ ነው የሚጠራው.
An apostle had to have a one-to-one with Jesus.
አፖስትል ሐዋርያ ደግሞ ከኢየሱስ ጋር ፍለፊት የተነጋገረ ሰው ሆነ.
So Paul certainly recognizes himself as an apostle.
ጳውሎስ ሐዋርያ መሆኑን ያውቃል.
Because Jesus came and revealed himself to him here.
ኢየሱስ መጥቶ ራሱን ገልጦለታል.
And he was blinded physically. And in his mind, perhaps permanently, before God speaks to him. And the other men as well, they heard something. God said to him, go into
Damascus.
And you will be told what you must do. Now God could have given him instructions there and then. God could have said to him, by the way, Saul. I want you to become a missionary. God could have put his hand on him and healed him there. But there's a process that Saul has to go through to become Paul. And it's
going
to take a few days. So there's something's going to go on in Damascus that will not only change this man forever, but will change Europe forever. This is going to change the world. This man is going to write most of the New Testament letters in what will be known as the New Testament one day. So it's a key moment. Just like in the chapter before, reaching Africa was a key moment. He needed a special agent, so he chose Philip. So to bring instruction and healing to Saul. Look at what it says from Acts chapter 9 verse 10. We'll read a few more verses. Read actually from 10 to 19.
በደማስቆ ሐናንያ የሚባል አንድ ደቀ መዝሙር ነበር። ጌታ በራእይ ሐናንያ ብሎ ጠራው። እርሱም ጌታ ሆይ እነሆኝ አለ። ጌታም እንዲህ አለው፣ ተነሳና ቀጥተኛ ጎዳና በተባለ መንገድ ይሁዳ ወደ ተባለ ሰው ቤት ሂድ። እዚያም ሳኦል የሚባል አንድ የጠርሴስ ሰው እየጸለየ ነውና ፈልገው። ምክንያቱም ሐናንያ የሚባል ሰው እርሱ ወዳለበት መጥቶ እጁን እንደሚጭንበትና አይኑን እንደሚበራለት በራእይ አይቷል። ሐናንያም መልሶ እንዲህ አለ፣ ጌታ ሆይ ይህ ሰው እኮ በኢየሩሳሌም ባሉ ቅዱሳን ላይ ምን ያህል ጉዳት እንዳደረሰ ከብዙ ሰው ሰምቻለሁ። ወደዚህም የመጣው ስምህን የሚጠሩትን ሁሉ ለማሰር ከካህናት አለቆች ስልጣን ተቀብሎ ነው። ጌታም እንዲህ አለው፣ ሂድ ይህ ሰው በአሕዛብና በነገሥታት ፊት እንዲሁም በእስራኤል ሕዝብ ፊት ስሜን እንዲሸከም የተመረጠ ቃይ ነው። እኔም ስለ ስሜ ምን ያህል መከራ መቀበል እንዳለበት አሳየዋለሁ። ሐናንያ ሄዶ ወደ ተባለው ቤት ገባ። በሳኦል ላይ እጁን ጭኖ፣ ወንድሜ ሳኦል፣ ወደዚህ ስትመጣ በመንገድ ላይ የተገለጠልህ ጌታ ኢየሱስ ይበራና በመንፈስ ቅዱስም እንድትሞላ እኔን ልኮኛል አለው። ወዲያው ከሳኦል አይን ላይ ቅርፊት የመሰለ ነገር ወደቀ፣ እንደገና ማየት ቻለ። ተነስቶ ተቀመጠ፣ ምግቡን በልቶ በረታ።
So here is Ananias.
ሐናንያ ያውላችሁ።
And we know almost nothing about him.
ስለዚህ ሰው ግን ምናውቀው ነገር የለም።
We know that he knows the layout of the city because he knew what Jesus was talking about when he told him to go there.
ከተማውን ያውቃል። ለዚህ ነው እዚህ መንደር ሄድ ሲለው የት ነው ብሎ አልጠየቀ።
He wasn't a refugee from Jerusalem.
ከኢየሩሳሌም የመጣ ስደተኛ አይደለም ማለት ነው።
He was well respected amongst the Jewish population.
በአይሁድ መካከል የተከበረ ሰው ነው።
He's described as a disciple.
ደቀ መዝሙር ነው ተብሎለታል።
But he was clearly also a prophet who God spoke to. According to tradition, he was martyred in Eleutheropolis.
No,
but we know nothing about him.
ስለሱ ምናቆ ነገር የለም.
But can you imagine if you were part of that church?
ናንተዛች ቤተክርስቲያን አባል ብትሆን እስቲ አስቡት.
I suppose it would be like being told that ISIS has arrived.
And ISIS መጥቷል እንደማለት.
Or the Taliban has moved into Addis.
ወይም ታሊባን አዲስ አበባ ገብቷል እንደማለት.
They're intending to destroy the churches.
ቤተክርስቲያንን ለማፍረስ እየተንቀሳቀሱ ነው.
And there's one man who is the worst.
አንሰው ሁሉ የከፋ ነው መሪያቸው.
And his name is Saul.
ስሙም ሳውል ይባላል.
And so he has come to your city.
ወደ እናንተ ከተማ ገብቷል.
Now what better way to be accepted than pretend to be a disciple?
ተቀመስ ሙር ለመሆነ ከመስመሰል ይልቅ እንደዚሁን ቁጭ ሲታወቅ እንዴት ጥሩ
What a brilliant way to get into the city and get people to trust you.
ያ ከተማውስ ገብታችሁ እንደዚህ ብላ እንደዚህ ነኝ ያላችሁ ወቸው ሰው አይቀበላችሁ
But God has spoken to him.
እግዚአብሔር ግን ተናገረው.
And God has chosen him.
እግዚአብሔር ደግሞ መርጦታል.
And the church is petrified.
ቤተክርስቲያን በፍርሃት ተመታለች.
They don't know what is going on.
ይሆን እንደሆነ ግራ ገብቷል.
They just know that a man is coming to their city to destroy them.
አንድ ሰው እነሱን ለማጥፋት እንደመጣ ሰምተው.
So God comes to Ananias.
ያንን ወደ አናንያ መጣ.
And says to him, Ananias.
አናንያ.
Hey, it's me, God.
እሺ አቤት አናንያ.
Arise and go to straight street.
ተነሳና ቀጥተኛ ጎዳና ወደ ተባለው ሰፈር ሂድ.
And find the house of Judas.
የይሁዳን ቤት ዛ ታገኛለህ.
Because Saul of Tarsus is there.
የጠርሴሱ ሰው ሳውል እዛ አለ.
I mean he could have said sorry run that by me again.
እስቲ ነገር እንደገና አደገምልኝ ሳይለው ቀረ ይመስላችኋል?
You said Saul of Tarsus.
የጠርሴሱ ሳውል ነው አልከው?
It's like Saddam Hussein.
ለከቆ ሳዳም ሁሴን እንደማለት እኮ.
Hitler has come for tea.
ወይም ደግሞ ሂትለር መጥቷል እንደማለት.
Are you sure?
እንግዲያኛ እግዚአብሔር እንደገና ነገረኝ እስቲ
አጥ I've heard things about this man.
እኔ ልንገርህ እኔ ስለዚህ ሰውዬ ብዙ ነገር ሰምቻለሁ.
I've heard what he's done to our people in Jerusalem.
በኢየሩሳሌም የኛን ህዝብ ምን እንዳደረጋቸው ሰምቻለሁ.
So obviously news of Saul had gone before him.
ስለዚህ የሳውል ማንነት አስቀድሞ እዛ ከተማ ገብቷል.
So when they met as a church.
ስለዚህ ቤተክርስቲያን ሲሰበሰቡ
this is one of the things they would have talked about.
ምናልባት ስለዚህ ጉዳይ ብዙ ጊዜ አውርተዋል.
Be careful this week.
ተጠንቀቁ በዚህ ሳምንት.
Keep your doors locked.
በራችሁን ቆልፉ.
Don't go out.
But
above all, don't get any visitors into your home.
Lock your door.
But God says to Ananias, I want you to go to this man. Well, God says something to Ananias. The Lord does. He says he's praying. Saul is praying. But he's already had a vision. He's seen you in a vision.
But I quite don't know.
Ananias is probably thinking, great, why did you choose me?
He's
already seen me in a vision.
If
the guy isn't genuine, he's already seen my face. God's given him a personal picture in his heart of me. He knows who I am. If I say no now, I won't be able to show my face again. He'll recognize me. Ah, you're the guy in the vision.
Oh, antana yayewrai.
But he has seen you, Ananias.
Aito hanilo.
Put your hands on him.
Inji sechino pataito.
What?
Men.
You want me to go into the room with him?
Inesu kifili gaba.
You want me to put my hands on him?
Jeni nesu malichi.
Well, can I please choke him then?
Ishi basizaw ndanqaw fekarli.
No, that's not what I mean when I say put your hands on him.
Yemane kagelglot adellem yesetta.
He's blind.
Tsuayne sewrnu.
And I want you to pray that he will be healed.
Indi fawassallet.
Wow,
migarmu.
He has authority to come and to bind all the sins.
Suko lemasar ko dabdabe yizo yemetta sewiyeku.
But the Lord said to him, go.
Yeta hida.
For he is a chosen vessel of mine.
Suko yetamarata qaim.
to bear my name before the Gentiles, kings and children of
Israel.
But then God says something that maybe Ananias would have enjoyed. Verse 16. Okay, Ananias, I'll show you. He's going to have to suffer. Is that all right? I'll make him suffer for the gospel. Maybe that made it easier for Ananias to
share.
I don't know. But Ananias heard from God. And God just used a simple word. He said, go. And when you read through Acts 8, Acts 9, Acts 10, it says that when the Spirit spoke to Philip, he said, go. Here the Lord speaks to Ananias, says, go. In the next one, when God speaks to Cornelius, he says to him, go. Send for Peter. So there comes a time for us when we will hear the word go. We are a called people. But God then calls us to go. And so he does go. And look at his response in verse 17. He goes, lays his hands on him, and says, brother Saul.
Here the Junch Anabat Wendeme Saul.
That's wonderful, folks.
Yes, Garum Nagarma.
God didn't say to him, go and call him your brother. But God told Ananias, I've accepted him. So he sees him and says, brother Saul. Isn't that wonderful?
I remember that.
Brother Saul. So he has believed God. The Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you came, sent me to you that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. So he puts his hands on him. The man is healed. It's like scales fall from his eyes. And his life is changed forever. He is filled with the Holy Spirit. I guess he starts speaking in other tongues. And he is then baptized. Can you imagine when Ananias talks to the rest of the church?
It
says, oh, come on over to my house, boys. I'm
going
to have a special baptism service tomorrow.
Praise
the Lord. We're having a baptism service. I love baptism services. As long as the water's not too cold. Let's have a baptism service. How many are we baptizing? Are they children? Are they adults? Oh, we're just baptizing one. Oh, wonderful. Grown up. And who is the new believer who's come into our midst? Oh, his name is Saul.
Saul Imbala.
Saul of Tarsus.
Yet Arsesu Saul.
Sorry? Can you imagine? Ananias. Last Sunday when we met, he told us to lock our doors because a man was coming to destroy us. I thought his name was Saul of Tarsus. Are there two of them? No. Saul has come to know Jesus. So Ananias was so convinced by what God said to him that he threw himself into his
work.
And and knew that God was transforming this man. So said to his brothers and sisters in Damascus, trust me, guys. This is a genuine conversion. This man has come to know Jesus. So in verse 19, he fed him. He's having now injera. He's being strengthened. And it says he spent some days with the disciples at Damascus. So he has now convinced the church that this is God. But do you see how random this whole thing is? We have the Bible. So we can read the stories. And we can work our way backwards. And we can say, yes, they were obedient to God. But if we were to imagine this happening today, not the same story, but another story. God is looking for people who will be his special agents, who will know him so well, will understand how to discern his voice, that when he says go, they will respond, I will go.
But
they
go on here.
So like Philip, go.
Philip was hit.
So he went.
Hit it.
Ananias, go.
Ananias, hit.
So he went.
Hit it.
Cornelius, go.
Cornelius, hit.
Peter, go.
Petros, hit.
So they went.
Unumid.
In Ethiopia today,
Zari be Ethiopia.
God is looking for people who will go.
Jabir, she will not meet you in the village.
You see, the Ethiopian eunuch.
Ethiopia, which under Abba.
It was probably known in the palace of Candace,
when they say this, the baby that must be talked about,
that he was trying to find God. I don't know that for sure. But I know for the man to be able to go to Jerusalem in a chariot, he had to have permission at the highest level. But his prayer was, God, I want to find you. And I can't find you. I went to the temple where I thought you would be. You might have been there, but I couldn't see you. So please send me someone who can show me how to find you. And around Ethiopia today, there might be thousands of people praying that same prayer. God, I need to find you. I want you in my life. But I don't know how to find you. I don't want to go to church because my grandmother died of cancer. And I have difficulty believing you. I'm disappointed, God. Just like the Ethiopian eunuch was. But God, if you would send me somebody who would come and meet me where I am, then I will follow you. That prayer could have been prayed today. Somewhere in Ethiopia. God touches one of his special agents. Says, I want you to go down to the coffee shop. Oh, you'll get a good macchiato there, but that's not the reason I'm
saying.
There's somebody there I want you to meet. Can God work that way today? Can God be that specific? And the thing is this, is that when we hear instructions like that, usually that person is a key person that God will use you to unlock them, but
will
use them to unlock a people group. And then it grows. We know nothing about Ananias. We don't know if he was married. He probably was. We don't know if he had children. He probably did. We don't know what job he did. Was he a pastor? Was he a full-time leader? Probably not at this stage of Christian history.
I talk.
But he was a man who knew God. We don't know what role he played in the church. He was clearly trusted by the church. But we don't know what he did. We don't know what he did in his social life. Whether he liked watching Manchester United. But he'd have been disappointed if he did. We don't know what he did, what food he liked to eat. All we know is he's a local believer in Damascus. His name is not recorded anywhere else. Now isn't that amazing? I think there should be a book written about him. The first book of Ananias. I'd read it. Why did God use him? Why did God not intervene and miraculously heal Saul? This was a release of the greatest missionary evangelist that ever lived. And yet God used an anonymous man to be a special agent for his kingdom. So I believe God wants to use us. And as I go through these different, some of them are very clever people. Some of them are people that you would expect. Tomorrow morning I'll be looking at Rahab. She was a special agent. Though I don't know if you would ever have seen her in that way. She was given a special word at a special time. And God used her in a great way. But we would never choose her. I don't think she'd be the first one to run your ladies department in church. Let's find a local harlot. Probably wouldn't be acceptable. But to God, God wanted to use her. And where I'm going with it tomorrow, I'm going to finish it all with tearing our clothes. I've never preached, what I'm preaching tomorrow, I've never preached before. So I'm rehearsing on you. Because I'm actually sharing on the message tomorrow. I'm at a conference next weekend. I'm preaching, and what I'm preaching tomorrow is the message for next weekend. And I'm going to pretend I'm preaching. And then I'm going to rip my shirt off. I will have something underneath it, don't worry. I'm going to rip my shirt. Because some of God's special agents rip their clothes. And so where I'm going today in this is that there is no norm for a special agent. I'm an evangelical, brought up in the Methodist Church, experienced the fullness of the Spirit. So I'm probably a Pentecostal leaning Methodist. As I said earlier on, I'm confused. But I know the way things should be done. And I like order. If you spend much time with me, you'll see my life is ordered. It has to be because the countries I travel to. If you go into my office at home, I have a folder for every country I will go to this year. Everything goes into that folder. But when I've said this before, when I go and park my car, when I shop, I park in the same parking space every time. Because I'll not remember where it is if I park in a different place. I like doing things in order. My wife and I, we have a caravan. We tow it behind the car, like, I don't know what you'd call it, like a little house behind the car. What do you call that? And so we go and we go. Sometimes I'll take a few days for rest. But I want to go to the same place every time. And my wife says, but we need to go somewhere different. I said, I don't want to go anywhere different. I want to go back there. So I'm a boring person. And I like things to be the way that they are. That's what I like. And many of you are the same. So we come out on Sunday morning and we know what to expect in church on Sunday morning. Everybody will be sat in exactly the same seat. Just like you will be tomorrow morning when you come in. You are likely to sit in the same place. Because the Holy Spirit miraculously guides you there. And every Sunday morning we have a service. And in the UK, in our Pentecostal churches, I could write you out the service for every week for the next year. We'll start with loud songs. Then we'll have quiet songs. Then we'll have the announcements. Then we'll have the offering. Then the children will go to children's church. Then the man will preach the gospel. Then we'll have a response. Then we'll sing a song. And then people will go. And we say, oh, the Holy Spirit was wonderful. And all we've done is we've lifted the photocopier. And it'll be the same next week. Look at the person next to you. Oh, I am so boring. Tell them you're so boring. I know that's not true. But I want you to get ready. Because if I am hearing from God, then things are about to change. If I'm hearing from God, then some of you are going to hear some new instruction. If I'm hearing from God, get ready to listen to the Holy Spirit. Because He will give you something specific. A specific message for a specific target at a specific time. And just like Ananias, people might never know your name. They might never know anything else about you. But you are like a heavenly postman. You deliver your message, and the postman's not important. It's the message that's important. And Jesus who it points to. We are just faithful soldiers. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
God bless you.